When he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength and shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The gospel for this Sunday of Epiphany is taken from the first chapter of St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. And now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her at once. And Jesus came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And you may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In the Gospel of Mark, just 10 verses before our reading for this morning, we have the baptism of Jesus. And it's a scene that we can think of this morning as we witnessed Tobin baptized just a few minutes ago. This is how Mark tells us Jesus' baptism happened. It was Jesus, just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens being ripped and being torn apart. The word here in the Bible, the word is schizomai. It means a ripping and a tearing. You know, something that can't easily be put together. When you rip your jeans, which how many of us have ripped jeans on right now? Jeez, probably a lot of us, right? You know, you can't easily repair that. You can't easily mend that. Something that's been ripped or torn is not easily put back together. So we've got the Spirit descending from the heavens that were ripped and torn apart, and that same Spirit descended on Jesus, and that Spirit then possessed Jesus. The Bible says it was a spirit possession. That spirit possessed Jesus, and then that same spirit drove Jesus out into the wilderness. It called him out into the wilderness. And so when we baptize, the same thing happens. Or at least we think of the same thing happening. So when Tobin was baptized, when you were baptized, the heavens were ripped apart, the heavens were torn apart, and the Spirit descended upon Tobin and upon you and upon me.
and we were possessed by that very Spirit of God, and we were called into our Christian faith. God's Spirit, Mark tells us, came down like a dove and rushed into Jesus, possessing him. And that same Spirit rushes into us and possesses us. This is the way Mark's Gospel narrates the beginning of Jesus' ministry. He begins by proclaiming God's action of this ripping and this tearing, this schizomai action. And according to the eyes and the ears of Mark, the Gospel writer, this schizomai, this tearing work, this ripping work of God, this tearing of the heavenly places, this ripping apart of boundaries, is central to the work and the ministry of Jesus. So God desires a world in which the boundaries that separate people from God and from each other, all of those things that keep people apart, are in Jesus Christ ripped open or torn apart. So all throughout Jesus' ministry and his life, Jesus was a God that was on the loose, engaging in this ripping apart, in this tearing apart type of work, this schizomai type of work. God really on the loose in the world, jumping over the boundaries we have set up, or just plain tearing those boundaries apart, whether we like it or not, whether we are ready for it or not. And so there's something unsettling, isn't there, about this God that is made known to us in the Gospel of Mark. There is, I mean, because we kind of like to have a say in things, don't we? We like to have our plans that come to fruition. We don't like this God that comes to earth and rips open and tears things apart. It's a little discomforting for us to think about this schizomai work of God. And this morning in the Gospel of Mark, he tells us of these earliest disciples that had to reaffirm their faith in this work of God, this schizomai work of God. And whenever we gather for baptisms, guess what we do? We reaffirm our faith also in this tearing apart, this ripping apart work of God. And so we said the creed as a Christian faith, as a Christian community as well, to reaffirm our faith in this schizomai work of God. The earliest disciples had to do the same. They had to affirm their faith in this God who made their lives more complicated, not less complicated. They had to affirm their faith in this God that made their lives more demanding, not less demanding. Made their lives more chaotic, not less chaotic. Made their lives more challenging, not less challenging. Made their lives more whole, not less whole. Made their lives more transformed, not less transformed. Made their lives more holy, not less holy. And so when we affirm our faith, we affirm our faith in this very thing as well. The earliest disciples had to decide, and we have to decide, whether or not we are going to follow this type of God in the world, this wild, schizomai kind of God on the loose, who can never be contained or controlled or tamed. Whatever this schizomai kind of God is on the loose in Jesus, whatever this God has in mind for you and for me, my suspicion is, based on what we see in the Gospel at least, that we probably won't be able to fully control or tame this work of God. We just have to go with it. We have to improvise once in a while. We have to run alongside this schizomai God, trying to keep up with him and the work that he's doing, and the ways that he's leading us in this world. So apparently, apparently the word had gotten out of Jesus' schizomai, this ripping apart, this tearing apart behavior of God in Jesus Christ, that this God was on the loose. In today's gospel reading, Mark tells us about a crowd that was gathered outside the door of Simon and Andrew's home. In fact, Mark tells us that the whole city was gathered there outside their house. Can you imagine that? The whole city of Dawson gathered outside someone's home where they knew this work of Jesus was happening inside. So we have this image of this Jesus healing, right? Taking all of the people in this city and in this town and healing them, healing their physical ailments, healing their spiritual ailments, and word got out quickly. And so everybody came to be healed by this Jesus. And Mark tells us that Jesus healed them all. And you can imagine how exhausting that was for Jesus. So Mark tells us that when it had gotten dark, Jesus kind of slipped away, right? Jesus snuck away to a deserted place so that he could pray. And when Simon and Peter and Andrew and James, they wake up and they realize that Jesus is not out in the house, they, Mark tells us, go hunting for him. That's kind of a peculiar kind of word, isn't it? They were hunting for Jesus. Now, we hunt for things, right, in our lives. One of the things that I spend most of the day hunting for are my reading glasses, because I lie around different places and I never seem to be able to find them. Most of the time, they're right on top of my head and I don't realize it. But I spend a good portion of the day hunting for my reading glasses. And we talk about hunting for Easter eggs. Maybe some of you, a month ago, maybe you were hunting for Christmas presents that were around the house. So we hunt for different things. I have even hunted for my daughters from time to time on the weekend when I'm not sure I know where they're at. I call them on their cell phone to try to find out the whereabouts of where they are, you know. And now we have these little hunting devices on our phones where we don't even need to call them anymore. We can just push a button, and you know, if you're a parent of a teenager, I'm sure you know this, that you just push a button, and you automatically, a map shows up on your phone, and so you always know where your teenagers are. I am so thankful we never had that. Well, my parents that we have that technology today. We use that often, don't we, girls? Yes, we do. Sorry to embarrass you. We hunt for a lot of things, don't we? But even our hunting does not really compare to what's going on in the gospel lesson this morning. This type of hunting, the word that is used here in the Gospel of Mark, implies an almost violent, it implies an almost desperate type of hunting. The followers of Jesus were hunting Jesus down because they were crazed and they were desperate. The followers of Jesus were hunting him down as if Jesus was the only person on earth that could help them. That's the type of word that we get here. The followers of Jesus hunted Jesus down. Which makes me wonder, in my life, when I have been so crazed and desperate for Jesus, when I have hunted him down, and I'm thinking to myself, yes. Like some of you, I think about doctors' checkups, you know, and I think about those checkups differently than I did 20 years ago. When I go to the doctor now, even for an annual checkup, you know, they perform all types of tests and scans, and when you have those exams, they almost always say that they'll call you back, right, in 2 or 3 days. Well, at my age, I kind of worry days. And I know that many of you don't, but it is like for yourself or even for a family member to receive a phone call when the doctor says, we found something on that last scan. And we need to take a closer look. Well, that's when we hunt Jesus down. That is precisely when we hunt Jesus down. When we are so crazed and desperate for Jesus that we hunt him down for healing. In the Gospel of Mark, they look at Simon Peter and the other followers hunting Jesus down. And when they finally found Jesus after their hunt, they say to Jesus in just exasperation, everyone is looking for you. Everyone is looking for you. And isn't that true? Everyone is looking for Jesus. You are looking for Jesus. I am looking for Jesus. We are all looking for Jesus because we are all looking for healing. We are all looking for grace. We are all looking for mercy. We are all looking for love. Every one of us is looking for Jesus desperately. And there Jesus is. He's gotten up before dawn, and he's in a deserted place, and he is ready, and he is listening to your cries and to your prayers. That is the schizomai work of this Jesus. Amen.